Welcome to World Med School. My name is Ajay Kumar and I work for the Southeast Asia office of the International Union Against TB and Lung Disease in New Delhi, India, and lead their operational research activities. In this micro lecture, I am going to speak on operational research in tuberculosis care and control. This is the outline of my presentation. I am going to speak on three broad areas. First, I'm going to talk on the need for operational research. Second, I will define what is operational research and clarify the several jargon which is around this term. What are its objectives with a couple of examples. Third and finally, I will discuss issues around the current operational research landscape. Where are we and what needs to be done? If you have already heard Dr. Merillo's presentation, then it becomes very clear that tremendous progress has been achieved in TB control over the past two decades. And the Global TB Control Report 2012 clearly mentions that nearly 51 million patients have been cured, and as a result, about 20 million additional lives have been saved since 1995. And the global target, which is declining TB incidence, we are clearly on track. As the graph shows. But there are several challenges. TB incidence, while it is declining too slowly, and I think less than 2% a year. And it's really a shame that 1.4 million people still die of TB every year, which is a completely treatable disease. Nearly 8.7 million new cases every year, with only 2/3 being notified to national programs. Despite considerable progress, TB-HIV epidemic is still rampant in Africa. Better not talk about the response to MDR-TB. Of about 600,000 plus MDR-TB cases prevalent, less than 10% are diagnosed and treated in national programs. There's a vast, unengaged private sector with major gaps in financing for TB control. Clearly, if we have to achieve universal access, if we are thinking of achieving TB elimination, even if it is by 2050, we need to change the way we do business in TB control. We need new tools, new diagnostics, new point of care tests, new drugs, effective drugs, not just new vaccines. Fortunately, after a long lull in the TB world, there is now a new buzz, with several new tools already in place and several more in the pipeline. However, is evidence of efficacy in control laboratory conditions enough? Will these new tools be as effective when implemented in routine settings? Will they be cost effective? Can they be feasibly implemented and deployed at the field level, at the community level? How do we ensure that the benefits reach the most vulnerable, to those who are most in need of these tools? What changes are required in recording and reporting so that we monitor these interventions under program settings? We need answers to all these crucial questions, and they can be answered only by high quality operational research. So, what is operational research? Operational research has its roots in military and commercial sector and is often defined as use of advanced analytic methods to make better decisions. However, the application of operational research, or OR, in health and in TB control has been a relatively recent phenomenon. The simplest and practical definition of OR has been the one I found in an article in Lancet Infectious Diseases. It says, research into interventions, strategies, tools or knowledge that can enhance the performance of the program and improve health outcomes. I think there are two important points to emphasize here. One, the focus is on improving program performance and improving health outcomes. Second, the focus is on effectiveness and efficiency and not efficacy. Unlike basic science studies and randomized clinical trials, where the focus is on establishing efficacy, operational research focuses on effectiveness and efficiency. What's the difference? To clarify in brief, efficacy answers the question, can the intervention work under controlled conditions? Whereas effectiveness says, does the intervention work under routine conditions? And efficiency is all about improving the use of limited resources. Though there are several terms that are used, like implementation research, action research, health systems research, health services research, translational research, etc., etc., we are going to stick to the term operational research and use it. There are three broad objectives of operational research. One is to assess feasibility of new strategies or interventions in specific settings or populations, to create evidence and advocate for policy change, and the ultimate goal is to improve outcomes, program outcomes or health outcomes among the populations. Let's take a couple of examples to understand this. This is an operational research which was published in 2003. It's a study from Malawi which showed that it was feasible to offer HIV testing and cotrimoxazole therapy to TB patients, and it reduced death rates by about 25% and was safe. Now this led to an important policy change and provided evidence for countrywide expansion of HIV testing as well as cotrimoxazole treatment in Malawi. Okay, it changed policy, but did it change practice? Yes. This slide shows the progress in implementation of the policy recommendations in expanding HIV testing and CPT for TB patients countrywide from 2003 to 2008. If you go from left to right, you see that the uptake of HIV testing as well as the uptake of CPT has improved dramatically. Okay, this study changed policy, it changed practice, but was it effective in improving health outcomes? Yes. For the same time period, if you look at this table, it clearly shows that the treatment success rates among the TB patients increased from 71% to 86%, and during the same period, the death rates declined from 19% to 7.5%. An example of operational research which proved feasibility, led to policy change, which led to change in practice, and ultimately improved health outcomes in TB patients. Let us take another example of the application of operational research. Evidence from clinical research shows that diabetes patients are at 2 to 3 times higher risk of developing TB as compared to non-diabetic patients, and treatment outcomes among those who have both TB and diabetes are worse as compared to those with TB alone. With ever increasing numbers of diabetes patients across the globe, this could contribute to a significant burden of TB. Now, to address this joint burden of TB and diabetes, there is now a collaborative framework developed by WHO and the Union. One of the recommendations in the framework is to conduct bidirectional screening. However, the question is how to do it in routine program settings. Is it feasible and effective? Is it cost effective? Clearly an area for operational research. This was answered by an operational research conducted and coordinated by the Union in India and China in collaboration with the respective national TB programs and other important stakeholders. The effect is, within a year, the studies were planned, conducted, and published, and has led to a national policy decision that all TB patients should be routinely screened for diabetes mellitus. In other words, operational research can be an effective tool to bridge the gap between what we know and what we do, the so-called no-do gap or implementation gap. Let us quickly examine the OR landscape. Where are we today? First of all, I think there is ample political recognition of the need for OR. The fact that OR is explicitly mentioned as one of the 6 key components of Stop TB strategy is evidence to this. Global Fund for AIDS, Tuberculosis and Malaria allows 10% of funds in every country proposal to be allocated to monitoring and evaluation, including operational research. Operational research is being increasingly emphasized by donors, by technical agencies and NGOs at the global level. Despite all this, very little operational research actually gets conducted, and even much less gets published. Why? There are several reasons, and I'm going to discuss a few in the next slide. First of all, there is a lack of an enabling environment. Begin with lack of priority. NTP managers probably think operational research is not their job and they're too busy in service delivery. Second, there is a lack of strategically defined and prioritized OR agenda. Lack of collaboration with academic institutions and NGOs. Most of the research that do happen is probably donor-driven or driven by interests within research institutes and lack ownership by NTP. Lack of priority for publishing OR by journals. There is a perception among scientific community that OR is not high quality research and many journals don't find it fit enough for publication. And then there are other important issues like lack of resources, lack of capacity among the people, among the program managers, and lack of monitoring of the impact of OR. So, how do we address this? First of all is to create a supportive and enabling environment for operational research. To begin with, every national TB program should have its own list of operational research priorities. Now, there is a WHO guidance available which has listed globally what are the important priority research questions. Now, that can be used and via a consultative process within each country, it has to be adapted and a prioritized agenda should be drawn. Second, a partnership model is required where the questions of operational research comes from the national TB program and it gets implemented by research institutes and academic institutes and NGOs. Third, there should be an ownership of the research findings by the NTP managers. And to facilitate all this, probably a dedicated OR focal point who works closely alongside the national TB program manager is very, very useful. Fifth, integrating operational research into routine program activities with dedicated budget lines is going to go a long way in fostering operational research. And finally, advocating with the scientific journals the value of operational research and need to publish it. The other important related issue is capacity building. Previous models have been mostly theoretical and not focused on transferring practical skills. A paradigm shift in this approach is urgently required. The Union MSF and US CDC models of capacity building have shown promise. This publication in International Journal of TB and Lung Disease describes the Union MSF model in detail. During the past 4 years, several operational research courses have been conducted jointly by the Union and MSF in Europe, Africa, Asia, India and South Pacific regions. The outputs have been fantastic, with nearly 85% of all participants who attended these courses developing and implementing OR projects in their own settings and have been published. Several of them have impacted national policy and practice. Now, this model needs to be scaled up globally to have any perceivable impact. WHO Euro is branding this model of OR training as SORTIP, Structured Operational Research Training Initiative, and is planning to conduct the first course in Eastern Europe in collaboration with TDR, Union and MSF. I hope that this initiative paves the way for wider scale-up of this model worldwide. Finally, It's important to monitor and document the impact of OR on change in policy, practice, and health outcomes. This publication in Lancet discusses the four important stages listed after completion of OR and provides a framework to assess the impact of OR. Detailed checklists are available for those who are interested in assessing the impact of OR. In conclusion, operational research in low-income countries plays an important role in filling the gap between what we know from research and what we do with that knowledge, the so-called no-do or implementation gap, and thus improve health outcomes. Measuring and reporting its success is essential. I would like to acknowledge the following people for sharing some of their slides and advice. Thanks for listening.